You want to fight me? You must be tired of living. You are not ready. You must train. With a montage.
Like when I was in the Kumitable, it was to the death. I once saw mouse traps entered fed to a family house cat.
Welcome to the Boardgame Black Belt. Today, we're facing Rarrr versus Tsuro of the Seas. May the best board game win.
So to start the game, you're going to first choose a monster. You can just deal these out randomly. But here's an idea of what you might get. Go, hey, ka. Wagi Bo To Du Ko Ha Ho. These are all the different types of monsters you can get in the game. What's different about them is the types of energy that they're good, they can use down here at the bottom. And so that's why it's good to sometimes just force the characters to pick so you don't have to think too hard about it. And so he's got one of four types of energy in the game. He's got fire and electrical. There's also atomic and radioactive, which we'll get into in a minute. And you'll also notice that his name has the katakana for his name underneath it from the Japanese, one of the Japanese alphabets. So after you've chosen or been given a character, you're going to take these cards, which is the rest of your name. You get three cards randomly, and you're going to choose two of those cards to help name your character. Now the naming is, the katakana and the name really are just for flavor. What matters is the symbols at the bottom, which are going to help tell you what kind of powers you're going to have during the game. So this, it has atomic and the toxic here with fire and electrical. And so you would pick two of those three and return the other one to the deck. And that would name your character. Kuwafu. Or it could go in any order. It doesn't really matter. Fuwaku. Fukuwa. What matters is these symbols down at the bottom, which tell you which powers you can use, because next you're going to draft your hand. So you're going to, each player is going to start out with 12 cards. And they're going to choose one, and it's a drafting mechanic where they pick one card and they pass it around the table. The cards come in ranks of 1 to 3 and in 4 different types of energy. There are no 3s in this hand, so that's a bad start. So you players tend to take the largest numbers of the energies that they can use. So he has 1 toxic, so I can only use 1 card per round. And then I'm going to pass these cards around, and the next player is going to pass me his hand, and I'm going to take one from him and pass it around until you have 12 cards built up. So once your hand is built up, the person who is the angriest monster, which is just represented by this card, is going to choose out of the cities. So we're going to take 6 cities per round. There's 3 rounds in the game. And we're going to lay these out here for our targets. So each city is represented by the color, which kind of represents what part of the world they're in because they're in sets. And also have victory points, 5 being the highest in the game. And they also have a symbol on each one, kind of telling you what that monster or what city that city is best at defending against. So when the angriest monster is going to choose the first city, he's not going to want to choose something that he's really good at, such as fire, or he may want to choose one that he's really good at, such as fire. So let's pick the fire city, because I have plenty of cards to play. The fire symbol on that card only means that I use 1 less card of that type when attacking that city, which would hurt everyone else if they don't have a bunch of fire. So then we're going to take the bidding starts, and I'm going to take an attack card here. And the thing is, every round you can bid as long as you can bid 4 times on the same city, only using each symbol 1 time. So I might want to start out with, I can only use 3 electrical cards because my monster only has 3 electrical. So I'm going to start out with the 1 because I like to bid small to start out to see where it's going to go. One may fight me for it. And then I'm going to mark on my little dial here 1. Well, you might think that you can't count that high, but the numbers in the bidding really start getting up high, because after it may go around the table and the bidding may be up to 15 or 20 or whatever, and then I'm going to have to bring out the big guns. So I have 3, 4, 5 fire that I can use, but I can only use 4 because he's immune to 1. So I'm going to use 4 cards, and now I have 2, 3, 4, 5, but then you multiply times the number of cards in your hand. So that's a 20. So this is actually 5 times 4 cards is 20 points. So now my bid goes up to 21. And this proceeds around the table until everyone drops out or passes. Now, everyone that passes gets 1 of their cards back to put in their hand, and the rest of them get discarded. The winner of the city discards every card he used that round, and the person who drops out last gets back 2 cards of their hand so they can keep using. You have to use these 12 cards through all 6 cities, so you can't just throw every card you got at the first city and then you're out, and then you sit there while everyone else is collecting the rest of the cities. So these cards, if I win this, it would give me 2 victory points. And because in the advanced game, if you prefer to play, these symbols are collected in sets, and you can almost tell by the color. The colors, Lagos and Cape Town, are both in Africa, so they're both yellow. If you collect all the set, and sometimes if you collect 1 of each set, you get more victory points. And so you go around 3 times through a set of 6 cities, 3 times, and then the person with the most victory points wins the game. The only other cards I haven't mentioned is everyone gets a set of these boost cards. There's a 1, 2, and a 3 each player gets. These cards can be used at any time along with the other cards you play, but they don't count towards the card number. So this is not a 1, 4, 8 because I have 2 cards. This doesn't count. It's just a 1. This would be just a 4 times a 1 card. So this is a 4 score. But you can use it as any type of energy, so it will go along with fire just fine. But once you use these boost cards, they're out and you don't get them back. So you have to really plan, and the mechanics come in to where you want to We have a lot of people who lurk in this game and wait for the big victory point cities, and so they throw everything they got, and then they wind up losing all their cards because they missed it by 1 point. So not only do they not get the victory, the 5 victory points, they don't have enough cards to win anything else. So that's it in a nutshell. This thing dial goes up to like 159, I think. And some of the scoring matches will get up in those higher ranks of 60, 70s. That's about as high as I've gotten. But the artwork is beautiful. The best part is, for kids especially, learning the katakana alphabet. I use that a lot. And so even for me, it helps me to learn my katakana. And that's Rarrr.
Rarrr is a family-friendly game of city smashing, where players take the role of daikaiju, giant Japanese movie monsters, where they use their powers, such as fire, electrical, atomic, and toxic, to destroy the most cities possible for the most points. It's a beautiful, simple, colorful game that on its surface is very simple, but it's really very complex. About Rarrr is where it succeeds, it does so with teeth. I mean, the four color feel of the comics on the cover and on the cards are reminiscent of those comic books that you grew up with, and they set this mood. Unfortunately, that mood is misplaced. The lack of any kind of direction or dialogue on the cards leads the player to believe that your imagination is what's gonna win the day. It couldn't be any further from the truth. What lies below this charming, color-coordinated, beautiful box is a cold, calculating, fractally generated math wind machine. It's like poker, but with exponentially higher hand combinations and a weirder strategy. And then they paint this theme on it.
But I like looking at the pictures.
Back! Now don't get me wrong, I like this game. I like it a lot, and I've played it multiple times since I got it just less than a month ago. But where it fails is that they're trying to pull in the wrong crowd with the mechanic. I don't know, it's like they were trying to pull in some other crowd based on the theme.
Okay, in Tsuro of the Seas, you can see it's the setup is just like Tsuro, if you've ever played that. And the basic game is basically mimics that. So we're going to say that we got a four-player game here. And you're supposed to all be ships trying to navigate the sea without getting killed, basically. And there's a lot of chaos going on this board. So what you do is, first thing you got to do is, what makes this different than Tsuro is that it's got an element of randomness and chaos. In a four-player game, which is what I'm going to simulate here, you would draw six of these tiles with the daikaiju, which are the... monsters. Daikaiju, you know, in Japanese just means like giant monster. So we've got the six tiles here of the monsters, and then you're going to roll randomly with these gold and the blue dice to see where they go. And so you got the blue tiles or blue diamonds on this side and gold on this side, and you're going to match them up two and two. So you go down the two and meet, and that's where you're going to put this one here, and then you're going to roll randomly for each of them. Three and two. 5 and 4, 4 and 3, and 2 and 4. And one more, 2 and 2, 2 and 2. You can't do that one, so we're gonna roll again. We'll do 3 and 4. Can't do that one. 3 and 1. Alright, so you're going to spin these randomly, and then you're going to flip them all over to start the game, and then everyone's going to choose where they want to start their vote at. So, this guy may start here, he may start here. Most people tend to avoid the daikaiju, so I'm going to stay away from there. And then everyone's going to draw three of these wake cards in their hands. And these represent the wakes of the ships. And these are going to be played every round to determine the direction of your boat. But before you can move in this game, you've got to determine whether or not the daikaiju move, which are, they move randomly based on how you roll. And so if you look closely at one of these cards, you can see that they have a 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5 tells it to rotate, and that's the direction they're going to move in if you activate them. 6 doesn't do anything, it just brings out a new monster, and you can never have less than 3 monsters on the board. So if you ever have all but 2 fall off, then you have to draw a new one out and place it. And these things will move. There's some gold monsters, and there are some blue monsters. The gold outrank the blue, so they go first. And so to begin your round, you on the roll of a 6, 7, or 8, you activate the monsters, and they all have to move. So then you roll 1 dice, and 5, you would start with the highest rated monster, who is the highest number in the corner, but gold goes first. So this one would rotate, and then you would find the other gold monsters here in ascending order. So actually the 2 would go first, 2 gold, and 5 would move him in this direction, which would kill this one. And then this gold monster would rotate. And then you would start low on the blue tiles. So 5 would move him this way to kill this one. And 5 would rotate this one. And so you can see that the monsters can kill each other as well as you. But we still have more than 3 on the board, so, or 3 or more on the board, so you don't have to bring out any more monsters. So after you've activated all the monsters, if you have to do so, you play a tile, and you would move along the wake as it determined. And you just want to stay on the board. The object of the game is to be the last ship surviving. So you just continue that way, and then you draw your hand back up to 3, and then play continues around the board with the next player activating the monsters if he can. 9 does not activate the monsters, so he's safe. He just continues to play a tile. If you have to place a monster, if you roll a 6 after you activate and you roll a 6, you have to draw a new tile. You would place it according to where you roll, just like you did to start the game. 4 blue, 2 gold. You place the monster here. Now, if you happen to place a monster on top of you or where you cannot no longer move, where your next tile would have to be placed until you die. If you go off the board, and you're not allowed to do that unless you have no choice, if you go off the board, you die. If you collide with another ship, you die. If you collide with a monster, you die. Basically, everything on this board can kill you, so you just try to stay away from everything as much as possible. Now, that's the basic rules of the game. Just kind of like Tsuro, with a couple of obstacles thrown in trying to kill you at all times, so it's very chaotic. There's an expansion for the game called Tsuro Veterans of the Seas, which add a few tiles to the deck. In the Daikaiju deck, which is the monster deck, you can shuffle in these 2 tiles. One, which is it's called Uzushiho, which is Whirlpool. You would place it just like the same, the way that you would place a dragon. Only it only moves if the daikaiju don't. So you roll 6, 7, or 8 on your turn and these activate. If you roll anything but a 6, 7, or 8, this moves. And it has 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, and 6, it wouldn't move. And so you would move it in the direction that it was told to, and it will eat anything. It will eat daikaiju, it will eat your ship, it will eat tiles that are laid out on the board. It will remove them from the game. It takes care of everything. So you pretty much one extra level of chaos. The other one that will come in the Daikaiju deck is the Tsunami. And so you place it just like you would anything else. And so you have a 2. The 2 is the facing of it. And so then they have this, I'm sorry, the gold one is one that goes on the board. The blue one you keep until you actually use it. You line it up to show it's a facing of it. And everything on either side of the Tsunami is considered to be in the wave. And so if you pass through that Tsunami wave, you would have to roll whatever the facing number is or higher. 4 beats a 2. You live. You okay. But every time, every round, this goes that way as you go around the whole board. Everybody's turn, it stays there before the player who activated it comes back around, it actually moves towards its marker and grows in intensity by one. So now it has to be a three or higher to beat it. And as you can see, it will eventually get to four or higher, and so it gets stronger as it goes. And that affects everything across the entirety of the board. So if it passes into your lane, you have to make a roll to see if you die. Yet again, one more thing to kill you. Now, and to help you in the wake deck, they've added in the Mystic Portal, which you play in your hand. Basically, that's any time that you're about to die or you need to use it to escape, you can play it, move into it, and then you roll randomly to see where you appear. Three and two, you appear here, but if there's not a tile already there, you have to lay a tile. Now that can be dangerous because you have daikaiju all over the board, and so you don't want to land on one of those. And also, the second thing they add in is the cannon, which is the taihao. Basically, a cannon is you play in your hand, you can have up to two in your hand, or if you get one, you can replace, you can turn it back in and pull another wake tile if you don't want it. But you can save it in your hand, and right before a daikaiju is about to attack or hit you and kill you, you can play that card and kill it instead. And then again, remember, if you get below three, you have to roll to pull another one to put it back on the board. That's the game in a nutshell. It's a very chaotic game, but that's what makes it fun. Trying to survive against your friends who are trying to maneuver themselves, and their loops affect you, especially once you get a lot of tiles on the board, trying to send you off the board to kill you. And that is Tsuro of the Seas.
I played Tsuro a couple of years ago at a New Year's Eve party when a friend brought it over, and I have to admit, I didn't think I would like it. It's not because of the theme. I love the theme. It's because it was its overly dripping abstract theme. I don't like abstract games. I mean, your pieces were rocks. What's that about? Abstract games to me are for kids and non-gamers. I mean, chess is a gateway drug, baby. But I did have fun. That's the problem. The freaking pieces were rocks, and I had fun. So my friend went away, and he took his game, and I put it on my Amazon list for like a year. And then I went to Gen Con, and then I saw Tsuro of the Seas. It's like they added death traps all over the board and random chances to die in the decks of cards. It was awesome. It was dripping with Asian theme all over the box, and it's like sweet and sour sauce. And they replaced the rocks with boats. And it had daikaiju and cannons. And it's still an abstract game. But it too has its flaws. I mean, there's almost too many ways to die in this game. It feels a little futile, but not in that, let's see if we can beat the game kind of futile as in Robinson Crusoe. I constantly felt like I was on the edge of dying. But maybe that's a sign of an addict. Maybe all board gamers are addicted to self-abuse. And may I add, as a board game geek, that you can play this game without the daikaiju and without the cannons and without the whirlpools. And in effect, what you've got is Tsuro, the original. I mean, it's like getting two games for the price of one.
Tsuro of the Seas is an abstract game at its heart, but what it adds makes it so much more. You play the role of an imperial captain of the Red Seal, charting his way through mystic waters, trying to avoid daikaiju, which are these huge sea serpents that are trying to destroy everything in his path. The game box looks like it's designed after some fancy Chinese restaurant, and in the middle of it is all the good stuff.
So there you have it. Rarrr or Tsuro of the Seas. Both have daikaiju, and that's about all they have in common. I think the final winner here is gonna have to be Tsuro of the Seas, because Rarrr, while it is very cute, and I love the fact that you can teach kids katakana with it, the theme, it really could be anything with this game. You see monsters and you expect being able to use your, you know, and some people can argue that that's kind of what you're doing in this, but I really think you could do, you know, armies or whatever could be doing the same thing. And so for kids or teaching kids or having a good time with family, this is a great game, and it's a good bargain for it's about half the price of this one. But as far as a good strategy game that you can't go wrong with it. Everybody can learn this, and it's very chaotic. People just get excited about it whenever they're dying left and right. And that's one of the downfalls of it, is that you can get knocked out of this game very fast, but it doesn't take long to play. And so I think once they get the hang of it, you'll have a fun time with a crowd here. So Tsuro the Seas is the champion this time. We'll be right back.